Our next speaker, he really loves Barcelona. He spent some time studying there. Well, he says studying, but it's probably partying. Let's admit it. And so he's the founder of SeatGeek, one company that was founded in 2009 in New York. It's basically an event ticket marketplace, which has been recently nominated as best place to work. So without further ado, I like rock and roll, and you probably like rock and roll. So let's welcome Jack Groetzinger as a total rock star in the star grind fashion. Let's go stand up and give it up.
Thank you. Nice one. Thanks. That's pretty nice.
Yeah.
I'm John. I'm a partner at Accel. This is Jack. He's the founder and CEO of SeatGeek. And we're going to talk about some of the lessons that Jack has learned from scaling a consumer brand over the last 6 or 7 years. So let's start at the top. Tell us about your background and how you started SeatGeek.
Yeah. Started SeatGeek with a buddy of mine who I went to Dartmouth with. And the two of us were living in Boston around 2007, 2008. I don't know if any of you guys are Boston sports fans, but if you remember Boston sports, everything was blowing up and they were winning everything back then. And we decided it would be a good time to become sort of like amateur ticket brokers. So we were buying and selling on Craigslist just for fun. And we were making money and we thought we were geniuses. It was just because the Celtics, the Patriots were just winning. Through this, we were both programmers. We got really interested in scraping data off the internet, ticketing data, and became fascinated with how inefficient it was. And how little transparency there was, how much consumers were honestly getting tricked, and how they didn't know what they were buying. We were working on another startup at the time, so we sold that. We had become sort of so enamored with this market that we dove head first and figured there's got to be a better way to do this. People need more transparency. People love going to games, love going to shows, but feel constantly like they're getting ripped off when they're actually buying tickets to go to those things. And we wanted to really serve as a consumer advocate to help people feel like they had a good experience, not just going, but actually buying beforehand.
Awesome. Tell us a little bit about where the business is today.
Yeah, so SeatGeek today has got about 140 folks on the team, sell about $1 to $2 million worth of tickets per day. Most of those on mobile, so a really very mobile-centric product. About two-thirds of what we sell is sports. Most of the rest is music with a little bit of theater. Almost all of that in North America. We're just beginning to think about international, but almost entirely North America-centric.
Cool. This is the Built for Speed panel, so maybe talk about growth and both team and the overall business.
Yeah, I mean, so the business is growing quickly. Net revenue growing over 200% year over year. Importantly, we've tried to grow the team as slowly as possible. I think a lot of people think about team size as, it's a sort of vanity metric. People love to talk about how big their team is. I think it's ultimately cost, right? You want to keep your team as small as possible. So we've grown the team relatively slowly over the past 7+ years. One thing that has caused our team to grow a bit more quickly recently is we've been investing really heavily in customer experience, customer service. So there's some extra team growth there. We're investing very heavily in technology. So we've been adding more and more engineers. But other than that, we've kept the team relatively lean.
Yeah. You've always been a really product-centric company in a sector that historically hasn't had much product evolution. I mean, I still print out tickets occasionally going to concerts. Talk about your just product development philosophy at SeatGeek and how that's evolved as the company has scaled.
Yeah. It's interesting because we compete against companies like Ticketmaster, for whom arguably technology is an inconvenience. It's sort of something they've had to deal with. The internet is something that disrupted what was previously a very profitable and sustainable business model. So ultimately, that means that if we're going to win, it's going to be because of technology. It's not going to be because we have a monopoly. It's not going to be because we have a better legal team. That means we need to be better at building things more quickly than our competitors. There's sort of this trope of the quote-unquote 10x engineer, someone who can do something 10x more efficiently than other engineers. And I think it's sort of this trite term that I kind of cringe when I hear it, but ultimately that's the sort of engineer we're trying to hire and attract. And as a result, we've intentionally built really small dev teams, sort of mini dev teams around specific products of just exceptionally strong engineers, have tried to create an extraordinarily high hiring bar, which means we, as a company, overinvest everyone's time in recruiting. We try to spend about twice as much time on recruiting as sort of feels normal. And then with the remaining time, just make sure everyone's exclusively focused on building great stuff.
How many engineers do you have today at SeatGeek?
55 engineers.
Got it. And when we first got involved in SeatGeek, I mean, even 3 or 4 years ago, most of the customers bought tickets on the web and desktop. It's now, as you said, 80% mobile. How has that shifted your product mindset for building for a mobile consumer versus web?
Yeah. The biggest thing we've seen on mobile is that if you can win a user on mobile, there is incredible loyalty that just doesn't exist on desktop. So even if you have a quote-unquote loyal desktop user, they'll still shop around. Even the most loyal SeatGeek users on desktop will still occasionally look at other sites. It's not the case for mobile users. And the key thing, part of the SeatGeek product that has really enabled us to get very sticky traction on mobile, boils down to curation. Our most popular feature is something we call Deal Score, which is basically like a bang for your buck rating of how good a ticket is from a value standpoint. So imagine that there's 1,000 tickets for a San Francisco Giants game. A typical, you know, internet ticket website would rank those tickets based on price, with the very cheapest ticket first, which when you think about it, actually isn't very useful unless you're trying to go for the absolute smallest amount of money possible. So on a, you know, imagine a mobile app with 1,000 tickets sorted by price, you're gonna see 3 tickets, they're the very cheapest possible. It's sort of useless.
It's basically the Ticketmaster app.
I wouldn't say that, but you can say that. What SeatGeek does is instead takes those 1,000 tickets and we say, okay, of those 1,000, we're going to figure out what they actually should cost. We're going to look at what they do cost, and we're going to identify the 3 that are most underpriced. So we're going to say, okay, these 3, you know, one of them is cheap, but costs way less than it should. This one actually costs, it's relatively expensive, but it should cost, you know, 3 times more. And we surface those at the very top. So you get the 3 most curated best values surfaced right in front of you. That took about 5 years of work from a bunch of people on our team, but ultimately it means you get this sort of very curated experience that translated particularly well to mobile. And honestly, I don't think when we started working on that back in 2010, I don't think we had all of the foresight to say, you know what, mobile's going to be huge in 2017, and this is going to make it. But it ended up working out really well.
How's the business breakdown, iOS versus Android?
About twice as many iOS users as Android.
Yeah.
Although, interestingly, Android used to convert at about a quarter of the rate as iOS, and it's almost at parity now.
Yeah, interesting. Let's talk about marketing. When you first got SeatGeek going, you had a loyal, tech-savvy customer base that came to you. Over the last 18 months especially, you've started to spend a lot more on marketing, trying to build a national consumer brand. If anybody listens to podcasts, they probably have heard your SeatGeek ads. What are some of the lessons that you've learned from that turning up the crank on marketing?
Yeah. The podcast, in particular, have been one of our biggest surprises. Because so when you start, you sort of try the low-hanging fruit, kind of table stakes marketing channels, right? You do AdWords, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, that sort of stuff. And unless you're sort of doing things very wrong, I think most e-commerce businesses can at least, at small scale, make those things work. We then moved on to a bunch of more experimental channels, and a bunch of them didn't work. We learned a lot of lessons about attribution and how do you actually measure to see if things are working at all. I think ultimately going into it, it's impossible to tell for your particular business what's going to work and what's not. Podcasts for us were sort of an unexpected, huge success. There's something about sports podcasts in particular that just mesh very well with our audience. And I guess people that like to listen to Bill Simmons also really like to buy tickets on their phone because the conversion metrics align really, really well.
Yeah.
More recently, we've been getting a lot of traction with YouTube influencers. So basically, you know, offering, for example, to buy tickets to the Super Bowl for someone with a quid pro quo that they're going to record a video about the experience, post it on YouTube. Maybe with a promo code to get their followers to then go download the app. It's another thing that when I first heard that we were going to try it, I sort of rolled my eyes, but the ROI has been yeah, exceptional.
Yeah, interesting. How have you thought about marketing organizations, both performance marketing and brand marketing? And maybe talk about the org on the marketing side of the
house. Yeah, we've struggled, you know, we're a very sort of inherently quantitative, data-driven company. So the performance marketing stuff came very naturally to us because something we're very comfortable with. You know, you sort of invest $10 to acquire a user, making these numbers up, but invest $10 to acquire a user, see that user payback over time. You've got, you know, 100% return on ad spend in 18 months, and you can feel really good about that. When you move away from that framework, at least for me, it was always a little bit inherently less comfortable. But ultimately, we realized that we're competing against brands that have awareness that, you know, a few years ago was orders of magnitude larger than us, brands like StubHub and Ticketmaster. And if we want to really eventually eclipse those brands and become sort of the next iconic American live entertainment brand, which is what we want to become, you can't do that just by bidding aggressively on AdWords. You need to sort of level up in terms of how you present yourself to the world. So for us, that meant sort of forcing ourselves to become comfortable spending in ways that we couldn't very directly attribute back to return on ad spend, you know, that month. And we went sort of through this whole exercise as a team of, okay, if we can't attribute it this month, how are we ultimately going to like create a framework as an exec team where we can get comfortable with some sort of return, even if it's not this month? You know, if it's in a year, how are we going to think about return on investment for the money that we're spending on marketing, so that we can all feel good about the money that we're spending?
Yeah, and you built more of a brand team along with your performance.
Yeah, exactly. So we, you know, we went out and we hired a CMO who had that kind of experience because we, you know, we ultimately were 3 years ago we were a great product company, but I don't think we were as great of a company. And what I've been focused on over the last 2 or 3 years has been trying to make SeatGeek a great company so that we're not just great at building products, but we're also a great marketing org, a great finance org, a great operations org. And for us, that meant, you know, going outside of our current team and hiring great brand people who had experience doing that. So our CMO, for example, came from Time, where she ran brands like People and Sports Illustrated, and then had worked at a few startups as well. So had that sort of balanced experience that we just didn't have internally.
Yeah, cool. A lot of startups here, I'm sure, in competitive markets. Ticketing is certainly a competitive market. You have two really entrenched companies with Ticketmaster and StubHub. How do you think about, sort of David versus Goliath, how do you think about competing against those businesses that have really big budgets?
Yeah. It's tricky because, you know, we're not going to outspend them. What it's ultimately come down to for me is the fact that I think we sort of have to be authentic to who we are, and it goes back to a little bit what I was talking about earlier, how we started SeatGeek ultimately to be a consumer advocate because we thought that there was a lack of transparency in the marketplace. We thought that people were getting screwed over. I think that in some ways, some of the legacy ticket companies, like the ones that John mentioned, their whole business model is to serve as a layer of opacity to screw over consumers. And we can present like the fact that we are a consumer advocate as part of our brand position and really sort of stake a claim for ourselves, an authentic claim for ourselves in doing that. So we're actually just beginning to roll out sort of a series of marketing campaigns that are really centered around that, focusing on fans, focusing on how we're a consumer advocate for those fans and how we can use technology and data as like, you know, a means to an end, where the end is an amazing live experience, but ultimately all the people at SeatGeek are focused on building stuff to be an advocate for you, to enable you to have more of those experiences and enable you to do more.
Yeah, cool. You're based in New York and you have 150 people in New York?
140. 100 in New York, and then got an office in Portland, Oregon. I got about 25 folks there.
It's mostly customer support.
Customer CX, yeah.
As the business scales, how do you think about hiring people remotely? You're pretty focused around having folks in one place other than customer support, but how do you think about in one spot versus remote?
Yeah, you know, we try to keep everyone in New York. I think that there's pros and cons to having remote folks. Ultimately, it's better to have everyone in one place. Most of our remote folks were started in New York and had to, you know, leave for whatever reason, and we just couldn't sort of bear to see them go and leave the company, so we allowed them to continue to work remotely. But ultimately, I think there's sort of no substitute for immediate human interaction. So we try to the extent we can, keep everyone in New York and all in one place with, you know, a little bit of leeway when necessary to work remotely.
Yeah. And how's building a company been in New York?
It's been great. I think New York doesn't get enough credit. It's one thing I love about New York is I think there's less of a culture of turnover than there is in the Bay Area. So, and this is a little bit anecdotal, but, you know, just based on, you know, experience talking to other CEOs out here, there's more of a notion of, you know, once you've joined a place, you're sort of almost immediately thinking about, okay, where am I going to go next year? Whereas in New York, it's more of assuming, you know, as someone running a company, you can build a great place to work. People are really in it for the long haul. And no intention of leaving. And, you know, many people at SeatGeek have been there for many years. I think on one hand, that's just because the total number of companies is smaller, but also I think it's a little bit of a cultural thing where you're not sort of constantly surrounded by this bubble of, you know, competing alternative opportunities.
Yeah, cool. We got a couple minutes left. What's next for SeatGeek, next 5 years?
So, one thing that's been really exciting for us over the last year is speak a little bit about, specifically about our product. We've been around for 7 years, and for most of that time, we've been exclusively a consumer product, a sort of consumer marketplace for tickets. So if you've ever tried the SeatGeek app, then you've used that. We, for a very long time, wanted to also start a what in sort of ticket speak we would call a primary marketplace, a primary product, which is basically something that an actual sports venue or music venue could use to sell tickets. So this is something that would compete directly with a company like Ticketmaster. And you know, 5-6 years ago when we were really small, that just seemed like an unfathomably scary big thing to do. But as we got traction, the opportunity seemed, you know, so big that we finally felt like we were at a point where we could do that. So last year launched something called SeatGeek Open that is basically a radically open new way to run a box office if you are a sports venue or a music venue. So whereas the sort of legacy ticketing model, the Ticketmaster model, says to a box office, so let's say you're, you know, the New York Knicks selling tickets, it says you can only sell your tickets on Ticketmaster.com. The SeatGeek Open model is you can sell on SeatGeek, but you can also sell on any other ticket site, any other e-commerce site. We launched this last year and are getting, you know, a bunch of clients much more quickly than we expected. So it's been fun for us because all of a sudden we sort of have two lines of business, both complementary, but also separate. So some people on SeatGeek working on one, some on the other, some on both. It's been a very exciting thing within the company.
Yeah. And talk about maybe a couple of customers that you've signed up.
Yeah, so for us, it's a little bit of a chicken and the egg problem where ultimately we knew that sort of this was the better way, but to get clients, we needed to show that by using SeatGeek Open instead of an alternative like Ticketmaster, a client would experience more revenue growth. And to do that, you need clients in the first place. We were very lucky to kick this thing off by doing a league-wide deal with Major League Soccer. So sort of 7-year deal with Major League Soccer. The way that primary ticketing contracts work is they're usually about 5 years long, which means that it's a little bit frustrating in that you can't just sort of start by signing everything at once. So we have to wait for some of these contracts to expire, but started this year by ticketing the Major League Soccer team in Kansas City. So if any of you guys are sporting Kansas City fans, I encourage you to go this year because SeatGeek Open will be ticketing it. Any sporting
That's
Kansas City fans?
That's highly doubtful. In San Francisco. But you got a couple of really interesting customers coming up and some big announcements over the next 2 or 3 weeks.
Exactly.
Yeah, cool. We've got like a minute left. Biggest question of the day. We're both Clevelanders. Who's going to win the 2017 NBA Finals?
Not a popular opinion here. But I'm going to have to go with the Cleveland Cavs on that one.
Yes, good. That's a good place to stop. Cool, man. Thanks for doing this.
Yeah. Thanks, guys.